The science of derby, the science of derby, let's learn something new.
Hi, and welcome to the science of derby with me, Professor Legs. Today, we're going to conclude the thrilling trilogy of bearings, wheels, and stops with, obviously, stops. Before watching this video, I do recommend that you've watched and kind of understood the wheels video, especially because we talk about coefficient of static friction, coefficient of kinetic friction, how wheels move against the ground, which of course is essential to understanding stopping. So that's your prerequisite, that's your homework, make sure you do it first, and let's get right into stops. Here we have a wheel, and if this was a bicycle or a car wheel, when you have some forward momentum going forward, you can apply a brake or a reverse force to that momentum using like caliper brakes or disc brakes or something like that. Of course, in roller derby, we don't have brakes like that. And in fact, unless you run into someone or your bearings are horrible, there's no force in the forward and back direction that prevents us from moving forward, that slows down our momentum. It's just not an option. So the only option in roller derby is the sideways action of your wheels in order to slow you down. And if you're ready for a very profound thought, basically all of roller derby is the sideways action of the wheels. Think about it. All of your stride, all of your force, all of your moving forward is sideways pushing. All of your stopping is the sideways action of your wheel. There's no other option. All of your blocking, all of your juking, all of everything in roller derby is just the sideways action of the wheel. So simple. So profound, it's incredible. Make sure you understand it. Let's talk about that sideways motion. Here's a quick recap from the wheel video. So that sideways action, we can call it slipping or sliding or drifting or skidding, whatever you want. And if your wheel is softer or stickier, meaning that its durometer rating is lower, that means it's gonna have a higher coefficient of static friction, a higher coefficient of kinetic friction, meaning that it's going to be harder to start sliding and it's going to generate more friction and slow you down more once it is sliding. Conversely, a harder, slipperier wheel is going to have a higher durometer rating and a lower coefficient of static and kinetic friction. So much easier to get it sliding, and it's going to provide a little bit less stopping power as you're sliding. We are going to look at two types of stops in this video. The two most common types of stops, and arguably the most important, the T-stop and the plow stop. They're very similar to each other, and they're both great stops for starting to understand how the physics of stopping works. Now, for both of them, you really need to be able to balance on one leg. So if you're just starting roller derby and skating around on one foot is difficult for you, I recommend spending a little more time finding your balance and getting used to your stride before you spend too much energy on stops, because it can be really frustrating to try to find these positions and be playing with your pressure when you're actually having trouble balancing on that one leg. It's frustrating, it's not gonna work, and that's no fun, right? So spend a little bit of time. You can practice every day, standing on one foot, doing all sorts of stuff. Find those little micro muscles that maintain your balance, work on your core strength. In no time, you'll have that balance on one foot, and it's going to make working your stops that much easier. Okay, so let's look at that T-stop. It's called that because your feet make a T or an L shape. And it's that back leg that, as you see, is turned sideways that's going to generate all of the stopping power. So all four wheels are going to slide against the ground. You can see here I've cut away the top of the skate, and all four wheels moving sideways again are providing that stopping power. Now let's take a look at what's happening between each wheel and the floor and how that friction is being generated. When it's sliding against the floor, this is the kinetic friction situation, and the stopping power is going to be the coefficient of kinetic friction times the weight or the pressure you're putting into the ground. Here's that friction chart from the wheel episode. And the two points of friction we care most about, which is the maximum point of static friction, and then that slidey kinetic friction part of the graph. So if you're moving into your T-stop and you put too much weight on too fast, you're not going to be able to get over that maximum force of static friction, and your wheel's going to kind of go chunk, 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 and you're not going to be able to get that nice slidey gliding T-stop that we love so much. So to really get this T-stop, you need to be able to balance on one leg as you're rolling forward, turn your stopping leg sideways, and then very slowly put down all four wheels, very gently, because you want to move directly into that second half of that graph, the sliding kinetic friction part of that graph. And once you're there, you can increase the pressure and thereby increase your stopping power and come to a nice, wonderful stop. A couple things to note. One is that a lot of newer skaters will have the tendency to only go on two wheels and have their ankle turn in. And this is a dangerous position for your ankle and can lead to ankle injuries. So you really want to make sure you have all four wheels pressing down on the ground. It's going to give you the better stopping power, more friction anyway, but it's also going to protect your ankle. So just to recap on that T-stop, here's the best strategy. You want to bend your knee on the standing leg. This is going to give you the most control over how much pressure you're putting into the ground. You rotate that leg, the stopping leg, and you gently put it down all four wheels on the ground. You want to start with a very light pressure and then push harder and harder to increase your amount of stopping power. For newer skaters, in my experience, this is one of the stumbling blocks, is they're putting way too much weight down on that back stopping leg too fast, and they're not succeeding. What you really want to do is start light, get that slide going, get into that kinetic friction part of the graph, and then increase the weight, and you're going to have a lot more success. All right, let's talk about the plow stop, the most important stop in all of roller derby. So this is it. Listen up. Like any good derby position, you want to have your chest up and your knees nice and bent. This will help everything, I promise. A lot of skaters struggling with their plow stops simply aren't bent enough in their knees. So bend your knees. Then you're going to lift one of your legs up. Again, you have to balance on this one leg. Turn your stopping leg in and put it straight out in front of you. This is going to be your break. Then gently put down that foot in front of you. Just like the T-stop, you want to start with a light pressure to get into that kinetic friction part of the graph. Start that drift happening, and then you can slowly increase the pressure and increase your stopping power. All right, let's take a look at the weight distribution from the top down. So if I have my skates in parallel with my weight evenly split between both sides, and I move one leg in front with that weight evenly split, I'm not going to be able to stop. I'm going to be behind that static friction part of the curve, and I'm going to turn around in a circle, or my legs are going to get all tangled up, and it will be a sad day for all. If instead I keep most of my weight on the standing leg, and I just have about 1% on the front leg until that sliding happens, until I'm into the slidey part of the curve, and then I slowly increase the pressure to like 30%. That's when you get that nice screech and a beautiful stop. And that's the situation we want. A lot of newer skaters have trouble with this. They want to keep their weight balanced between both their legs, which prevents them from sliding. So it's really good to practice skating on one foot. And hey, you very experienced skaters, I know some of you have weak left plows. A lot of times, when you're doing your left plow, you're not having enough weight on your right leg, and you're not balancing enough on your right leg, and so watch this video, follow the steps, and your left plow will improve. Another common thing to see when people are struggling with their plow stops is that their weight is sort of pitched over. This is not great derby position. It doesn't put your head in a great place in a full contact sport, but from a physics point of view, it also takes the whole weight of your upper body and puts it over your front foot. So again, your weight's going to be split or more heavily in your front foot, which is going to prevent you from getting that slide or drift motion. It's going to prevent you from getting into that nice slidey part of the graph, and you won't be able to get your plow on. To fix that, simply bring your chest up, look straight forward. You know your feet aren't going anywhere. They're still attached, hopefully. And with that chest up, you can there more easily balance the weight on your back leg and just gently put that front leg down and get your plow. Quick recap on a great plow stop. You want to have your chest up, head facing forward, really bend on that standing leg. Get your other leg right on in front of you, and you're gonna slowly apply the pressure, starting about 1% and then moving up to about 30% to get this really beautiful, nice plow going on. Looking at the math, while you're sliding, we're sliding, so we're looking at the force of kinetic friction is the coefficient of kinetic friction times the weight, or the pressure you're putting into that wheel. The coefficient of kinetic friction depends on your wheel and the floor, but the weight you control, the amount of pressure you control, and the harder you press once you're already sliding, the more you're gonna stop. Greetings from the future. It's always really difficult to know how much analysis and math to put into these videos, but I've jumped back in time to insert this topic because I think there's gonna be a bunch of questions about it. And that is the angle of your leg during a plow stop. Now, there are a number of people that have this really wide stance during their plow stop, or possibly even do this swooping motion with their foot to get that sliding action we were talking about earlier. There are a couple of things wrong with this. First of all, if you have a really wide stance in your wall, and especially if you're swooping your leg, there's a good chance you might trip one of your own teammates or maybe your jammer as they come through, or you may trip an opponent, which is going to destabilize your wall and could land you in the penalty box, which is no good. But there's also a scientific physics reason for not having such a wide stance. Let's break this down. So if I've got a plow stop out here at about 60 degrees from that ideal position, and I'm trying to generate a braking force straight back into the jammer that's pushing on my back. So I've got this braking force coming through my leg. Let's say my braking force is 100. At an angle of 60 degrees, I'm going to use a bit of trigonometry here. I take the cosine of 60 times by my braking force, and you'll realize I'm only getting 50% of my braking power going back into that jammer. And that's no good. But it's even worse than that. So if my braking force is coming this way into my body, there's another component, another 50% of my force is actually going off sideways. And so my standing leg needs to resist that extra horizontal component to keep me in position. And it's even worse than that. Because my leg's out to the side, the braking force will be creating a torque or a moment on my body trying to twist me this way. So I have to use extra force in my hip to try to prevent me from getting twisted out of position. In short, there's a whole ton of extra forces and extra work I'm creating for myself just by having my leg out to the side. So that's no good. The ideal position you want is really heel in line with your hip, straight on your body. That's going to give you the maximum braking force without all this extra stuff going on. Now, let's be pragmatic. It's not always easy to have this perfect position. And so as you're training this, if you're at 15 degrees or 30 degrees, you're on the right track. All you need to do is just slowly work on getting it narrower and narrower. But at 30 degrees, you're actually doing pretty good. 90% of your braking power is going into the jammer, and there's not too much extra stuff going on. However, if you realize you're at 45 most of the time, or 60, or especially if you're training and reinforcing this big swooping motion, I really think it's worth it to take the time right now to re-examine how you're doing your plows and to train yourself to do it properly, to just reprogram that muscle memory to lift the foot up, heel in line with the hip, and slowly increase that pressure. Find the nuance between the weight on your standing leg and the weight on that plowing leg, and learn to get a really strong, solid stop without tripping anyone in your wall. And it's gonna take you really, really far in roller derby. Well, that's just about it for plow stops. But there's one more super important thing I wanna talk about, and that is that beautiful sound we all know and love when you get a really amazing plow stop and it kind of goes chugga, 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 because something different is going on. This is what we call chatter. And so it's not just sliding against the floor, but there's actually something else happening. Let's look at the situation. So you have this forward momentum that you're trying to break. You put on your really great plow stop, which is creating a force of friction in the other direction. And let's say you put just enough force, it's too much force for the kinetic friction, so you're actually pushing yourself back to that static friction part of the curve. So you have this huge forward momentum from all your speed, and then this big force pushing down into the ground, and the wheel can't move forward and backwards because it's turned sideways. What happens? That's the question. We're kind of in this situation where a whole bunch of forces are all colliding at the exact same moment, and we need to figure out what happens. First option, your wheel explodes because there's too much force from both directions. It can't go anywhere else. That's possible. Usually doesn't happen. Thank goodness. The other option is the two forces perfectly balance out. So you're going super, super fast. You throw in that plow and then all of a sudden, everything stops perfectly. That basically never happens. What normally happens, and actually what we want to have happen, is instead of your wheel exploding, what happens is it actually starts skipping a little bit. So it can't roll back and forth because you're holding it there with your foot. There's too much pressure for it to move into that drifting part of the curve. So it actually starts skipping over the ground a little bit. This is very similar to the anti-lock brake situation we were talking about in the wheel video. And this really keeps you on that static coefficient of friction part of the curve, which has more stopping power than the kinetic friction part of the curve. And it makes a really cool sound. And it's awesome. If you want to see chatter in action, check out the cool video link I put in the comments. It's of whips teaching how to do plow stops. And at the end of the video, there's a slow motion section. You can see exactly what's going on in the wheel. You can see it wants to go forward and back, but it can't. And it's doing this ch-chunk, ch-chunk in slow motion, and you can hear it, and everything is beautiful. And it will illustrate exactly what we've just been talking about. Thanks so much for joining me. That's about all I have for T-stops and plow stops for you, two of the most important skills in the game. I hope I've helped you understand how to break them down from a science point of view, but also some practical tips to help improve your game. And I've also hope you've enjoyed the thrilling trilogy of bearings, wheels, and stops, and I hope you join me again soon.
The science of derby, the science of derby, let's learn something new.